Hi, I'm Barton Seaver. I'm a chef, author, proud resident of the beautiful coast of New England, where we are joining you from today with my friend, mentor, and one of our culinary heroes.
Bob Rheault. I'm the executive director of the East Coast Shellfish Growers Association.
We've got an incredible range of oysters from the East Coast here. We're going to be talking about sustainability. We're going to be talking about how the oysters are grown, where they come from, and their flavor potential for you as a chef. So let's dive in.
Sure. So this is an amazing species. It goes from Atlantic Canada all the way down to Brazil, which is hard to believe. It's able to tolerate being frozen and baked in the sun at low tide. It can tolerate huge swings in salinity. And as oyster farmers, we're able to produce a year-round crop of wonderful animals of almost every different size and shape. Now here we have a nice collection of oysters that have been grown, and you can see they've been grown on the bottom. They're growing a little bit of seaweed. We've got oysters here that have been grown in a floating cage that tends to tide tumble them and round up the shell and sort of polishes them. We've got large animals for those who like a full oyster, a full mouthful. We've got petites for those who prefer a more delicate mouthful. They have a wonderful range of flavors that are imparted largely by the salt. I mean, I think that's the first thing that hits you, because your tongue is very adept to salt. As a chef, we all
Yeah, know. I mean, I add just a few grains of salt to whatever it is I'm cooking, and it dramatically changes. The same is going to be true with oysters. And that salinity is going to draw out other flavors that are endemic or sort of from that area. Tell me, where do those flavors come from?
Absolutely. It's a great story to tell here, Barton. We have a lot of products here. Everything you could hope for. A range of flavors, from a low salinity oyster grown in the mid-Atlantic to a very briny oyster grown in New England. So a lot of it is what you are accustomed to, what you prefer as a consumer.
Well, that's great. I mean, just think about oysters like wine. You don't want every wine on your menu to be this big, bold, fruity, juicy bomb, right? You want some acidity, you want some light, bright, you want a whole range of that. And that's one of the things that I, as a chef, have so long appreciated about the oyster, that even right in front of us here today, just these five different varieties, we're going to taste a radical diversity of culinary opportunity, really. So you had mentioned, as part of sort of the hardiness of the oyster, that these things live out in the natural environment. And so they go through a whole bunch of different, well, experiences. And it's all of those experiences that, in sum, lead to the flavor of the oyster.
The first thing I want to do is taste a naked oyster. I want to take out an oyster, and I could always say that I could taste the difference between my oyster and the grower who is growing right next to me. Mm-hmm. And these happen to be from my farm.
Cheers.
Mmm.
Salt, fragrant glory.
Mmm. Food like nature intended. It really brings me home. And we have a wide variety here. So these are from the mid-Atlantic, and they have a lower salinity profile.
So what's going to be the nature of that flavor? What's the sort of the first thing that comes to mind when we taste one of these?
Well, as we're coming into the fall, these animals typically don't feed when the temperature drops below 10 degrees centigrade. So they have to store up a lot of energy to make it through the winter. And they do that by storing a product called glycogen, which strikes your tongue as sweet. So a fall oyster has got a superb sweetness when you chew it. And
glycogen is a form of fat?
It's actually a disaccharide. So when it hits your saliva, it gets cleaved into a sugar. And that's why you taste sweet. But it's a storage product. It's actually what makes a scallop sweet. And it's more prominent in the fall. And then through the winter, that animal doesn't even feed at all. And then in the spring, it will fatten up with more of a lipid flavor, so a different flavor, but a charming flavor nonetheless. We cherish the flavor all year round, and we cherish the differences between the various farms, which are imparted, as you know, by the minerals and what they've eaten. And some of those flavor differences are quite radical.
The same animal put in two different locations, even very close together at times, can be radically different, and that's just an effect of the tides and the sun and the water temperature and the available feed, the salinity, all of these factors that go into it. So to me, an oyster is one of the most interesting of all culinary products that we have access to as chefs. And talk about putting compelling on a plate. This is it. So getting it to the plate. Tell me about storage. How do we store oysters, and what's the proper way to get them to market and onto the table?
The farmers have a lot of control over when they harvest. We can fly stuff across the planet. And the shelf life of this particular species is quite long, especially in winter. You can have these in refrigerated storage for prolonged periods, and the flavor will still be superb. In summer, you probably want to eat them within about 2 weeks. And of course, everything's better fresher, but they do last for a prolonged period. If you're going to be keeping them in the fridge for a prolonged period, I recommend storing them cupped down with a little bit of moisture so that if they do open up to get a little breath, after all, this is a live animal, all the liquor doesn't drain out and dry out, because that'll kill the animal. So, but typically, 2 weeks is probably where I would want to have them consumed by. We're doing studies holding them much longer and finding that a winter oyster in particular can survive much longer.
That's because the oyster naturally goes into a hibernation period for all intents and purposes. What about the practice of storing them wet, storing them in salt water once they get to a location?
Sure, I mean, that's something that is done for other species of oysters that tend to dry out quickly. This is really not necessary for this animal, and I don't like to recommend it because it radically alters the flavor. You lose that miroir, that flavor that is from the minerals and the native location where the oyster was grown, and it tastes like the water that you have in the tank.
Did you get that? Terroir, the concept that wines taste of place. Well, miroir, the concept that oysters and seafood taste of place too. It's a product worth being proud of. And as a chef, I mean, we know that story on the menu, the narrative of our own creative process, our process and care for sustainability and sourcing ingredients is key. And it's a fundamental part of modern cuisine, really. And I've always felt so much pride of product in being able to name the region, even name the farmer whose product I was serving. And so with that, to me, an oyster is amongst the most romantic of all foods. It is among the most delicious. It is among the broadest sort of culinary canvases availed to us as chefs. And hey, with that, there's your Northeast Atlantic oyster, all the romance of this place brought to you on the Half Shell. Bon appétit.